I'm Kellen Lee Marion, and welcome to STEM to Share. In today's episode, we're interviewing
Maquette Kark. I am in transition. I was formerly an education ranger at Acadia National Park. I am currently the acting administrative officer for interpretation.
Can you please explain a little bit more what it means to work in the field of interpretation?
Interpretation is the act of teaching and reaching out to help the visitors who come to Acadia understand the resource, so the coastline or the trees, the animals, all of those things that make Acadia unique. An interpreter is the educator or the teacher there, and then administrative officer. I have moved more into a secretarial role where I am handling payroll and I am scheduling and working more on the inside, the inner workings of the park.
What other national parks have you worked at?
Originally, I got my Park Service start at the Black Canyon of the Gunnison, which is in and near Montrose, Colorado. And then I worked on the Grand Mesa, Uncompahgre, and Gunnison National Forests. So I was actually a forest ranger for 2 years.
What inspired you to go into your career?
I was one of the really fortunate students. So I graduated from high school and we actually had a couple of rangers come to our high school and say, we have careers and positions available for high school students to work 3 months. You know, you can go to college and then you can work for the Park Service. And when you're 18 and you're choosing between working at Target or for the Park Service, you're like, oh, that sounds amazing. So I started almost by chance. I had a really wonderful supervisor who saw something, saw some potential, and I fell in love with working for the Park Service.
Can you tell me a little bit about your educational background?
I did the whole public school route for elementary, middle, and high school. I got pretty good grades. I was a fairly studious student. So then I went to college and I actually was going for education. So I thought I was going to be a teacher. But as I mentioned before, I was working in the parks every summer. And so I had this pull and this love of what I was doing every summer. And by the time I was teaching, so I taught in a classroom for several years. And then Acadia said 1 year that a position was available and I applied for it. And I was like, okay, yeah. You know, if I don't get it, I'll just continue to teach. And I actually got that position for the Park Service.
What do you find exciting about your job?
I love that every day is so different. I love that this is a mission that people can really get behind. So, you know, there's a lot of jobs out there and there's a lot of wonderful, amazing opportunities in work. But there's something so noble and incredible about the fact that every day I know that I am making a difference protecting our public land. I'm protecting space that belongs to every single person in the United States. I am helping and impacting this beautiful country for future generations. And so there's a real legacy and honor to being a park ranger.
What advice would you give to students looking to work at a national park?
Supervisor explained being a park ranger as your job is to be curious. So ask questions, do research, never stop being curious. And so I think that is the pivotal piece of it, how you do that, whether you go into a biology background or a history background or teaching or speaking a foreign language. There's multiple different avenues to being a ranger, but I think the real crux of it is stay curious.
What part of your job benefits the general public the most?
We would benefit the general public in everything that we do. These federal lands are designed for the public. This is your space. This is my space. This is our children's space, our grandparents' space. So we should be thinking about how our roads are maintained for people to explore and experience. We should be thinking about how the water quality, the air is going to be impacted. And what's amazing about places like Acadia, Joshua Tree, anywhere really, is if you look at the water quality here or the air quality here, we are directly impacted by Boston, Philadelphia, all of these larger metropolitan areas. We can tell the differences and changes in pollution and air quality. So what happens somewhere else impacts the national parks. And so I think that that's a really exciting microcosm and really exciting place for science to take place, that we can say, this is what a landscape that should be safe, untouched looks like. And if it looks like this, what does that say about these other places?
What is special about Acadia National Park?
Acadia became a national park in 1916, which is pretty early in the Park Service history, Park Service world. 1916 is actually when you get the Park Service. So Acadia, when people first came here and said, I think this is something special, noted that it had a pretty tall mountain for the coastline. So where we are located, we are right on the coast of Maine. We are a pretty large island for the coast of Maine as well. So you have a mountain right there on the coastline named Cadillac Mountain. You have granite shoreline, this beautiful pink Cadillac Mountain granite that creates these large cliffs that the water comes and bashes against. But since granite is such a hard rock, won't erode very quickly. You have forests and pristine landscapes. What's really cool about Acadia is, again, being an island on the coast in the middle of Maine, you actually get a fair amount of northern species coming in, as well as southern species coming in. You get some temperate, warmer days, so some other species will come, as well as some of those colder winters, which will bring other species. So you get to study this playground of biologic diversity here that makes it very unique.
What's your favorite spot in Acadia?
When I first got here, I didn't have a car, I didn't have any mode of transportation, and there were these carriage roads. And the carriage roads are like this crushed stone, 16 feet wide, and they go for miles. We have 45 miles of carriage roads in the national park, and I remember riding my bike around them and getting to walk them and feeling like I was in this jungle and completely inside of a forest, which was such an amazing experience.
Can you please explain who built the carriage roads and why?
The carriage road system was designed and paid for by John D. Rockefeller Jr. And John D. Rockefeller Jr. actually vacationed here. He first came here in 1908 because his wife's gynecologist doctor was here, and she was pregnant with Nelson Rockefeller at the time. And so they first came here, had their baby. You can imagine, there just must have been so many feelings of closeness to this area. It was so peaceful compared to the loud and smelly New York City. And so one of the hobbies that John D. Rockefeller had was to build carriage roads. So he loved to go out in what was called four in hand. So he would have four horses and he would hold them all in one hand on the reins. And he would take his horses out on a carriage ride. So at first it started on his property and just built some carriage roads. And then he got this idea. You can almost imagine like this vision of what would it be like if you could ride from the southern tip of the island all the way up to the northern. And so he began slowly buying up land and on his personal property built all of these carriage roads. And there was some pushback from other visitors, from people who are like, oh, who's doing this? Who's making this loud noises to build these roads? You know, there's a lot of construction happening. And then once the roads were built, it was this just gorgeous act of both architecture and engineering, and he donated them to Acadia National Park when he was finished with the project, and he maintained all of those carriage roads until the 1960s.
Are you aware of any research projects in the park?
You can probably see research is one of the things I'm very, very passionate about, so there's multiple projects. There's more than I am going to be able to list, describe, even think about. Because you're in a national park, you're in this place where people will pull permits to go out and do research every year. I think this year we're going to be looking at people who are studying Daphnia. So those are little microorganisms in vernal pools by the ocean. So they're studying to see how these animals survive in those pools and learn more about them. Some people call them sea fleas. For those of you who are like, what's a Daphnia? There's going to be research done. There's almost always some sort of research that's ongoing about Cadillac Mountain. Cadillac is kind of has an alpine terrain. right? So it is does not have very much soil. It's going to be a little bit taller than the rest of the island. So there's a lot of plots where people will see what grows best there. How if we were to try and replant Cadillac, because a lot of people have stepped on it and walked on it and killed plants that were there originally, how do we revegetate an area? There's a lot of climate change studies that are happening. So there's ocean monitoring that measures water temperatures and sea level rise, but there's also going to be studies going on about how does a plant do when it has, so part of the reason for studying on top of Cadillac, these are strained, stressful conditions. What plants do really well in those strained, stressful conditions? Can we move, are those plants going to be the ones that migrate farther north with the climate changing? Are there going to be plants that we lose? So a lot of monitoring of those, as well as continued monitoring of invasive insects. So we're always looking out for the emerald ash borer, the Asian longhorn beetle, and a couple other invasives such as that.
How can students learn about your residence program?
Always checking out our website. We update it daily. So going to nps.gov/ACAD and visiting the Acadia National Park website is a great place to learn about volunteer opportunities, is a great place to learn about programs that we offer to schools. There is a section that is just for students. So if they wanted to learn and research something, there is a whole section about wildlife, plants, etc. You also would want to probably check out our friends group, Friends of Acadia. They are constantly doing things. They're also creating new jobs. So we have jobs, especially for high school, that the that the Friends of Acadia sponsor. Some of those are summit stewards, and summit stewards' jobs are to hike up mountains, talk to people about leave no trace or how to protect the environment. We also have some that are media tech. So if you are really into photography or making videos or doing some sort of media creation, there is a team that goes around all summer long and takes pictures for Acadia National Park. So most of those are happening through our partner groups like the Friends of Acadia.
Thank you all for watching, and please follow me on Instagram and Twitter. And thank you to my interviewee for participating in my project, and their links will be in the description below. Bye!